The Bank of Uganda maintained its benchmark lending rate at 6.5% as interest rates remain at record lows to spur growth. The bank, however, warns that as the country recovers from COVID-19, continued global chain supply interruptions together with difficult financing conditions could affect the economy. Welcome to the Business Show. Now here are highlights from the world of business. Uganda's economy grew by 6.5% in 2021, says Bank of Uganda. IRA unveils Insurance Product Innovation Awards 2021. URA confiscates smuggled cosmetics worth 2 billion Uganda shillings. Tusky's Imara to be auctioned over unpaid loan.
Well, you know, by 2025 and 2030, we are targeting production of 20 million bags.
We need a civil society to understand what are some of these repercussions when we talk about the Energy Charter Treaty.
Welcome to the show. Now, as Uganda awaits, among other African countries, an invitation to accede to the Energy Charter Treaty, Southern and Eastern Africa Trade Information and Negotiations Institute, CETINI, is carrying out dialogues to fully expose the challenges ahead of what has been described as the most dangerous treaty in the world. We speak to Brenda Nkunda from CETINI to better understand what dangers await Uganda in the Energy Charter Treaty should the country go ahead. Views from the top. Welcome, Brenda, to the set. What is the Energy Charter Treaty and why is CETINI Uganda so concerned about it?
Okay, thank you very much. I am Brenda Akankunda. I do work with CETINI Uganda. CETINI is Southern and Eastern Africa Trade Information and Negotiations Institute. Now, the Energy Charter Treaty that you refer to as the ECT is a multilateral investment agreement that was established back in the 1994, immediately after the Soviet Union, with an aim of protecting the investments within the energy sector. And at the moment, we are seeing a movement to expand its membership, especially within the Global South. So that is one of the major reasons as to why CETINI has come up to express a lot of interest, because according to the studies that we have conducted, we have realized that the ECT at the moment has some of the clauses that we refer to as problematic, and we think should be reviewed before any member states decides to join the treaty. And most importantly is because in 2019, Uganda wrote a letter to the ECT secretariat expressing interest to join the treaty. So that is why it is a timely movement for us to come and try to advise the different stakeholders on why we think at the moment it is not a good decision for any country to be a member state to the Energy Charter Treaty.
You mentioned something about other countries being members already. So how come you look at it like it's really dangerous, yet you have the European Union, you have some countries from the US being a part of it?
Okay, according to the assessment that has so far been done, one of the things that we have realized is even those that are already members to the treaty, most of them are exiting the Energy Charter Treaty. That is a first sign that there's something wrong with it. But also, adding on, when you refer to some of the recent reports like the UNCTAD report of 2020, it shows that the Energy Charter Treaty triggered most of the investor-state disputes as opposed to any other treaty. So those themselves are very huge threats. And when you look at countries, especially countries like Uganda, that are developing countries that do not have enough resources that could be lost in case a dispute maybe arises in form of compensation, then we realize that it is not a good decision for developing countries to make a decision of trying to join the ECT, because even those that are already member states are also planning on how to exit that particular treaty.
I understand the ECT aims to strengthen the rule of law and reduce risks in the energy sector investments. So isn't this something Uganda should be happy about instead?
The Energy Charter Treaty has some of the claims that it makes, and on the onset they seem to be claims that any state should be, you know, happy about. But the reality is different from what the actual claims are. And we talk about the reality because we have seen what has happened in the countries that have joined the Energy Charter Treaty. Much as these claims are made, the reality is different. So we do understand that Uganda especially needs to increase its investment when it comes to the energy sector, because for instance our access to electricity is still low, and these are some of the opportunities that we look at and could probably say that this Energy Charter Treaty is an opportunity that Uganda should really be happy about. But we also believe that Uganda does not need this particular single treaty for it to increase its investment, especially within the energy sector. So there are other different alternatives that we think the government could try and look at instead of just the ECT, which has already been earmarked as the most dangerous treaty that we have in the world at the moment.
So Uganda already took its first step of the steps required to join, and that's signing the International Energy Charter. So how possible is it to educate the stakeholders involved that the country is about to make a big mistake?
Okay, what Uganda has done so far, yes, they've sent a letter, but the opportunity here is that at the moment, the ECT Secretariat has halted accepting membership. So that gives us some time to plan and prepare and look at and use this time when the ECT is apparently being modernized to advise our governments to engage with these different ministries. The ministry in charge of this is the Ministry of Energy here. So we look at how we can engage with them to ensure that at the moment they halt, because we think that if maybe later in time some of these that we refer to as the problematic clauses are addressed and revised, then maybe it would be a treaty that we could explore. But at the moment we could use this opportunity now that the ECT Secretariat has halted, and it is not, it is giving us some time to prepare, and this is a time that especially as civil society we can continue engaging in dialogue with these different stakeholders and advise them. And one other thing I actually want to note is that this Energy Charter Treaty is an international investment agreement. Now when you look at all the international investment agreements that we do have here, they are negotiated and signed by the Ministry of Finance. Now this one falls under the Ministry of Energy, which has not always been negotiating such investment agreements. So we feel there's even need to create that link between these two different ministries, so that there's a lot they could share in terms of experience and also get to learn more about.
All right, thanks Brenda. One of the concerns is the treaty binding countries that might later want to adopt climate friendly energies. So how realistic is it for countries to solve energy poverty but in a climate friendly and supportive format?
Okay, actually thank you Varela for that question, because one of the problems that we do look at associated with the ECT is the fact that it is climate blind. Because I could give you an example, some of the campaigns that have been going on talk about things to do with the fossil fuels. So Uganda may wake up and make maybe a directive to stop extracting fossil fuels from the ground. But the moment we have the Energy Charter Treaty in place, then it means the country has made a commitment to a certain investor to protect their investment, say maybe in extracting fossil fuels. And by coming up with such a directive, so as to promote say climate justice or environmental justice, then that will be looked at as a breach of the existing contract between Uganda and that particular investor, and that will lead or trigger an investor state dispute settlement. So those are some of the main challenges that we do look at, because right now it is a moment where we all need to talk about climate justice, look at how we can adopt some of the climate friendly policies, look at how we can mainstream principles of climate justice within our natural laws. So the ECT is a contradiction to that, and that is actually why we think that this is a great movement, especially to maybe those that are advocating against climate change, to get to understand the repercussions associated with the Energy Charter Treaty, especially when it comes to the issue to do with climate.
Do you believe in any effort to support climate moves, we can be able to solve energy poverty doing away with fossil fuels?
I believe that there are always alternatives that we can explore. I believe that we do not need the Energy Charter Treaty to solve the energy poverty. And I also believe that there are alternatives we can take to address the energy poverty and even bringing on board the issue of the fossil fuels. But all coupled together, I think that there are already policies, good policies in place, like the Paris Agreement. Every other time we see at the conference of parties, like the most recent one that happened, we see member states coming up with different solutions to address these challenges and also address the energy poverty. So we think all those alternatives should be explored. And if we explore those, then we can be able to address and cover that gap that exists.
So mining of fossil fuels and other related energies is not the only problem that's facing causing climate change. So how possible is it then that people can give up on that oil and actually explore more alternatives while other things that we are doing on the planet are actually creating climate change?
Viola, I think that when we bring in that whole discussion of oil and gas, most times we tend, I think there's actually need for us to do maybe more studies trying to analyze, because much as we may argue that some of these renewable energies are a big threat to the climate, maybe there are those that we have actually not looked at. So there's also need to go beyond this little information that we have, do very critical studies, get to understand. And we also can't run away from the fact that we need the revenue, we need the resources. So look at how we can alternatively be able to collect the resources. Maybe at the moment we are extracting, we have the oil and gas industry that seems to be promising, but also look at how best we can be able to bring on board policies that are climate friendly, to be able to have a win-win situation where we have the oil, but at the same time we are promoting the environment and climate justice.
Thank you, Brenda. Now, with so many campaigns aimed at saving the environment and reducing effects of climate change, should such a treaty be signed by Uganda, we could indeed have a reverse effect on such goals that we've had on saving the environment. You're watching The Business Show. We now go for a quick break, but we shall be right back.